Okay, so I'm a psychologist and methodologist, and psychologists, like many other researchers in other fields, they are very fond of p-values. This leads to a lot of mockery, like in this article, a herd of p-values spotted approaching significance. A group of field biologists in Tanzania have spotted a herd of p-values approaching significance. Lead investigator Bruce Rosen is still excited about the sighting. It was amazing. An alpha male, a majestic 0.06, was slowly but truly approaching significance, followed by a herd of a small group of marginal p-values. First, the p-values formed a uniform formation, possibly as a distraction, and then they slowly approached significance. Okay, this is how, in psychology at least, we see statistical results being reported. And this is mandated, at least by the American Psychological Association, the APA. This is a typical result in a way in which a p-value equal to 0.05 is presented as being significant, which in a way is interesting. And of course, you can recompute these p-values fairly easily. And if you do that in this case, you would find out that it's 0.06 rather than 0.05, hence not significant, even after taking into account rounding. And my former PhD student, Marianne Bakker, drew a very large sample of 250 plus papers and recomputed all these 4,720 p-values from t-test, f-test, chi-square test, and correlation test, as well as z-test, and checked for consistency. And what she found was fairly disheartening, in the sense that half of the papers showed one or more errors in reporting of p-values. Now, some of these were fairly inconsequential, but also we found in 39 papers, about 15% or so, at least one result that was erroneous and bared on significance. So a significant result insignificantly presented, but mostly the other way around, and most of these errors led to better results. We also found that this was related to data sharing, which is, like in other fields, mandated by journals and professional societies and moral ethical guidelines. This is a fairly small study, so in need of replication, but in this study we found that those who do not share data make a lot of more of these gross errors, these really relevant errors, as opposed to those who do share data. Now, this is from a blackboard in a room of PhD students at the University of Amsterdam, where I did my PhD. So this is then obviously how we teach our students. In a trichotomy in this case, but often in a dichotomy, P is smaller than or larger than 0.05, significant or not. And this leads to a lot of trouble, particularly in fields such as psychology, where the sample sizes are small and the effects that you are studying are equally small, leading to low power. Some estimates show that it should be around typically 0.35 or even lower sometimes. Now, it doesn't surprise me, and it didn't surprise other methodologists, that this leads then to a lot of the questionable research practices and analysis of data. And in a way, it's fairly weird that we would use blind observers, blind experimenters, and whatnot, as though the data in favor of these effects is convincing, which I actually don't think. We have someone who's clearly interested in a particular result, who has very clear expectations, run the analysis by themselves. This is a survey by Leslie John and colleagues a couple of years ago among 2,000 research psychologists in the US, and she estimated the prevalence of these different questionable research practices in a particular way. I'm not going to go into detail. And the most commonly assessed behavior was failing to report all dependent measures. So basically, as I interpreted, choosing between different outcome measures, deciding to collect more data after seeing whether the results were significant, which is optional stopping or sequential testing, for which you need to correct the p-value, but people don't. Traditional publication bias, etc. And if you look carefully here, you see in a paper rounding off a p-value equal to 0.054 as being smaller than 0.05, the behavior that we were able to assess. Now, what is interesting about this result is that the data formed a Goodman scale, which means that if you answer yes to a particular practice that has a low prevalence, you basically typically also answer yes to the more prevalent behaviors. This means then that if you say yes, that you misreported a p-value in such a way, you're likely to also say the other behaviors that you've done those. This means that the misreporting of p-values around significance is a good indicator of other questionable research practices related to significance testing. So we now developed in our Tilburg University team an automated procedure, open and available in the software package R called StatCheck, which runs this process automatically. So poor Marianne, who did that all by hand, we now can do this automatically. It's a text scraping tool. It looks for results of TF, chi-square test, and z-test, and correlation test in the full text, and then checks for consistency. Now, with this method in place, we could do a large sample, basically population of all articles in several high-impact APA journals. So these are the prime journals in our field. From 1985 until 2013, so nearly a 30-year period, I tend to say, of about 30,000 papers, and this is a subset of 18,000 thereof, in which if you have good eyes, you can see that on the left-hand side, about 75% or so of the articles report some of these results that can be read by our automated procedure. And also on the right-hand side, that among those journals that report these p-values, they report a lot of them. And actually that the number of p-values in articles in psychology on average has increased over this nearly 30-year period. Now you might wanna, this is an interesting question. So if it is a good indicator of questionable research practices and publish or perish is the root cause of this, and the pressure to publish has increased, you would expect an increase also in the prevalence of these gross errors. This is actually not what we found. Interestingly enough, if you look at all errors combined, including the less severe ones, we could corroborate the earlier result of 50% across the entire range over time. And the gross inconsistency rate at the article level, so the articles that showed at least one of these erroneous p-values related to significance, actually dropped considerably in this 30-year period. Now, you can do all sorts of interesting stuff with this. I'm not going to go into too much detail. You can also, of course, check the number of non-significant results presented, and a proportion thereof actually has increased over this period. So psychologists then tend to show more non-significant results, which I think may be a good idea and would be a sign of improvement according to some views. We also can look at the distribution of p-values between 0 and 0.05. There's some recent results suggesting that you can actually observe p-hacking behaviors by looking at this distribution. This does not appear to be the case. There's just a few, like sequential testing, that you could actually observe under some circumstances. But this is a mass data, so there's a lot of p-values that you see here. And luckily, the curve goes up, so not all of psychology's results are false positives, luckily. But that's about it, what you can tell on the aggregated level. So if you really want to go into understanding these different topics, you have to focus on particular research lines. This is also what we do now, actually. This is a new meta-analytic technique published this year in Psychological Methods. This is a meta-analysis that, if you are familiar with them and view the funnel plot, is utterly weird. The reason is that all these dots lie on this barely outside of the funnel. And the p-value distribution of those that are below 0.05, most of them actually, is shown to the left. Now, this should be uniform if the null hypothesis were true. It should be skewed towards zero if there is some effect. And it should be, it could be skewed in other direction only if there's particular questionable research practices that have been used. Now, you can estimate if it's a new method, in a fixed effects model, what the effect is, and you actually estimate a negative effect here. So this is a research line. It's about whether if you feel something heavy, like say a clipboard, that you assess particular information about persons, say a job candidate on that clipboard, to be more important or better as opposed to when you hold a light clipboard. Now this is published in Science, one of the first articles on this, but I would not say that this is replicable. Actually, we couldn't replicate it either. So what's next? First of all, we could use an expand StatCheck or similar text scraping tools. And, Malcolm mentioned some of this work related to other aspects of the methodology. And I'm more than happy to work with people who are interested in that to try to include other types of reporting. This not only allows for meta research, but also allows the use of that in peer review. Just like we now have plagiarism checks, which are fairly commonly used now, and checks for image manipulation, which in some journals lead to clear trouble in 2% of the submissions and a lot of rejections for that reason only, you can use that in the peer review system, making it easier, or at least efficient to check and avoid these problems. We can also work with what I call a co-pilot model. As I mentioned, doing analysis is very error-prone. Some of these errors are just honest errors, which are likely to occur if they align with your prediction, with your expectation. This is traditional confirmation bias. So what we could do then is to share those data and codes with others for independent verification. Now, of course, the question here is who's going to do it? How are you going to incentivize the checking of these results? And this is not an easy feat. There's a scarcity, perhaps, of statisticians and methodologists who would like to do that, so you need to incentivize that somehow. Maybe by awarding points, or again, handing out badges, or offering co-authorship for true independent corroboration, and then add someone, or add an analysis paper to the original paper as a peer-reviewed publication in itself, and then have the original paper have one citation already, you know? Okay. This is another issue, I'm not going to go into that. There's another interesting thing is that you can also take a step back and just accept the fact that there's massive fabrication bias across the fields and try to develop methods that can still estimate effects under the most extreme types of fabrication bias. And this pre-uniform method that I don't have time to go into is at least aimed to do that. It's meant to do that. It's still under development in a way, but it accepts the fact that there are these problems and just see what's going on. I want to thank the research group, the funder, and you for your attention. Thank you.